Hi, I'm LadyJenevia. The embargo has lifted for the new Jason Momoa film, so let's talk about it. This video is a review of Slumberland, which is a new Netflix film releasing next week on November 18th. Make no mistake, Jason Momoa is the entire reason I wanted a screener of this film and am choosing to review it, but he's not actually the protagonist of the story. A young girl named Nemo is the one who we follow. Nemo lives in a lighthouse with her father, but one day he is sadly lost at sea. I will admit that when I first watched the film, I was a bit unclear at first on what had happened to her father, because I couldn't tell if the story was going to be some sort of magical adventure where her father was kidnapped by a magical monster and Nemo would have to go rescue him, but he is in fact dead. Nemo has to go live with her uncle and things are awkward between them because of his personality, or lack thereof.
School is not a prison.
Can I leave whenever I want to?
It's a little like a prison.
And also because they never had a relationship before this loss put them in each other's lives. Therefore, she starts to dream of a place called Slumberland. It's a dream world, as you can probably guess by the name. And it's there that she meets Flip, an eccentric, fantastical creature portrayed by the one and only Jason Momoa. Now, the target audience for this is probably children and families in general. But if you're like me, and Jason Momoa being a main performer is reason enough to ask for a press screener and tune in, then oh boy, you're going to have fun with this.
I'm a flipping outlaw, so I don't play by the rules, but here's the rules.
The thing about Jason is that because of his appearance and his stature, a lot of the roles that he gets offered and that he books are ones where he is playing tough, physically intimidating, gruff characters. However, if you follow this man on social media, if you watch his interviews, you know that he has a great sense of humor, he can be very playful, and his work in Slumberland as Flip is completely transformative to what most people know him for on screen. He, in this film, is downright silly in the best way. Obviously, if you've seen the movie poster or a trailer, then you know that he has a bit of a physical transformation to play Flip with the outfit, the ears, the teeth. I feel like he's going to be a really fun character for cosplayers to recreate, but ultimately it's the behavior and energy that completely sold me on this character. Jason is so silly and playful and mischievous playing Flip. He is pure id in a very family-friendly way, of course. It's a kid's film. It's only rated PG. But in this film, he serves looks, he dances, he speaks Spanish, and when I say Spanish, I mean Spanish, as in, I heard this man say gracias, but maybe that was just the fake teeth he was wearing. He also calls cops pigs.
If the dream pigs catch you, they will... Oh, my bad, buddy. If the dream cops catch you, they will lock you up and throw away the key.
I have never seen this iteration of Jason Momoa on screen before when playing a fictional character. Jason Momoa playing Flip is a bit like if you take that energy he has for tackling his friends and you combine it with him in that one interview he did in Australia where he's wearing pigtails with scrunchies, that's sort of an idea of where he's at with this role. Whenever there is an actor whose work I admire, but a lot of their work has them playing more serious or dramatic roles, but then you come to find out that their interview persona is more comedic, it always makes me want to see them get to do more comedic roles in order to diversify their filmography. And Slumberland is a prime example of exactly that for Jason Momoa specifically. Now, fair warning, if you are watching this film for Jason Momoa, you do not actually see him for the first time until about 20 minutes into the runtime. That introduction is a brief one, and then you probably don't start to see him in a more prolonged sense as far as scenes and sequences until closer to about 30 minutes in. There's a fair bit of establishing that needs to happen in the story for the protagonist, Nemo, before she is able to go on her adventure with Flip. Once we, as the audience, get to see this dreamland, Slumberland, explored by Nemo and Flip, it's a really vibrant and diverse viewing experience because as they go in and out of different people's dreams, you're able to see how each person's dream is very different. So you can tell that the people who designed this world really had fun with it. Now, I'm no stranger to being critical of visual effects, but to be honest, there were a lot of good ones in the world building of Slumberland. One of the first dreams that Flip and Nemo visit is probably my personal favorite to look at. This movie is first and foremost a kid's film. It has a child protagonist. It's only rated PG, but it's not unbearable to watch if you're an adult either. I found it to be really sweet and heartwarming, as well as a surprisingly thoughtful meditation on grief and loss following the death of a loved one. There is a lot of work done in the writing to explore Nemo's feelings and her struggles over losing her father when she was just a child. It's scary and confusing, and there are some interesting philosophical or even existential questions posed about how she wants to deal with this loss or how she should deal with this loss. If we think about a film like Mrs. Doubtfire, where it's very much a film geared towards families, and the main catalyst of that story is a divorce, even with all the humor and antics of that story, it's really thoughtful in how it addresses that more serious subject matter. If you go and watch the interview some of the cast did for the 25-year reunion of Mrs. Doubtfire, they talked about how they often hear from people who were children of divorce that watching the film helped them as a child. I don't know if I'm just understandably disconnected from most PG-rated films nowadays since I'm not the target audience of them, but watching Slumberland did feel nostalgic in a way of a simpler, more hopeful time, including how I experienced entertainment media as a child. I love how the story has a whimsical sense of fun and adventure, while also balancing things out with a more mature emotional subject matter. On the one hand, you have a visually vibrant, fantastical world to explore, but on the other hand, you have a child who wants to just stay asleep instead of being out in the real world. Sleeping all the time because you're sad? Is that or is that not a symptom of depression? In terms of allegory, it's a fitting comparison, and even though the story is focusing on Nemo's loss, and Jason, Flip, is there to provide humor, levity, mischief, and a childlike sense of wonder, Flip also has his own emotional layers to unpack and explore once you get further into the story. I find it interesting how so many blockbusters that are seemingly supposed to be for adults, based on their rating by the MPA, a lot of those blockbusters are seemingly becoming more childish, which can suggest a collective stunting of growth and emotional development in the larger masses, and I definitely think that part of that childish dumbing down of blockbusters is a strategy to try to make more money. But I would argue that a film like Slumberland is far more palatable to me as a viewer if we are comparing it to the large array of releases that are seemingly intended to be more family-friendly. You have humor without undermining the dramatic stakes or tension of a story, but you also have emotional depth without being too heavy-handed with it to the point that it would become a burden to the viewer, and then you leave the cinema or couch feeling despondent about what it is that you just saw. I think that balance is deceptively difficult to achieve, but Slumberland, in my humble opinion, was successful in doing so. Nemo is not exploring Slumberland simply for the sake of escapism and wanting to have fun because real life is too sad for her. That type of approach is probably better reflected in something like Shazam, when you see a stark contrast between how Billy emotes when he's Shazam versus when he's just Billy, the teenage boy. In Slumberland, Nemo and Flip both have a goal. They have a mission to find something that they think will bring them some sort of happiness or freedom that they are currently lacking. And that definitely comes across in the overall momentum and pacing of the story. I'm trying to keep my description vague, since unlike some of the other Netflix films I am doing reviews for, this one has an embargo that is lifted with a good week or so to go before the wider release of the film on the Netflix platform. What exactly is the reasoning behind publicity teams doing embargoes for some films where the film comes out at midnight and then the embargo is more or less exactly the same time as that release? I have no idea. Maybe they just don't trust the critics to rate holiday rom-coms favorably, to which I say, maybe you need to do a better job of curating the reviewers who actually like rom-coms and will give them a fair shot when reviewing them. But I digress. Back to Slumberland. I went into the viewing experience not expecting all that much. I hoped that it would at least be a bit of fun for whatever Jason Momoa would be doing, and it completely outdid those minimal expectations I had. I had not even watched a trailer for this. I had no idea what I was going into. I had seen some still images and character posters floating around online, but apart from that, Jason was my only window into this project. I was not familiar with the source material, and apparently this isn't closely following the source material anyway. Walking away from the viewing, I found that I really enjoyed myself. I don't consider myself someone who gravitates towards all that much new media that is made with a target audience of children or sometimes even teenagers, but I really enjoyed Slumberland. I don't really have much in the way of major complaints. Occasionally, some of the visual effects, I mean, you could tell that it's actors being shot on some sort of blue screen, but I have seen and will probably continue to see far worse in other things. There were plenty of VFX heavy shots in Slumberland that were highly effective in immersing me into the visual world of this fictional universe. As far as comedy, adventure, and emotional heart goes, I do not have any major notes or critiques to give. I rated the film overall 4.5 out of 5 stars, and if you're new to my rating system for new releases, particularly on a platform like Letterboxd, I try not to overbestow 5-star ratings for films when they are first released, just because I'm trying to create some sort of ranking for myself privately, just in case I decide to share some sort of top 10 list at the end of the year. And I haven't decided yet if I will actually end up doing a video on that, but all that to say, it gets confusing if I just succumb to my initial emotional reaction of being excited about watching a new release and then giving everything 5 stars, but plenty of things can eventually be converted to 5-star ratings once I continue to rewatch those things in the years that follow their initial release and they grow on me. So regardless of whether or not you like the more family-friendly, family-oriented films, regardless of whether or not you have children or young relatives in your life for whom this film might be especially geared towards, I think it's worth checking out once it releases on Netflix. At the very least, I hope Jason gets more hype as a comedic performer once Slumberland comes out. I don't necessarily want to see comedy being forced into certain roles he already has going, like Aquaman, though that character, I will say, works very well with a more of a dry, deadpan type of humor in his writing, or things like when he aggressively points at Barry Allen in Zack Snyder's Justice League. That always makes me laugh. But I'm more so referring to a very high energy, full out style of performing comedy. Jason definitely shows that he can deliver that in Slumberland, so if more writers, directors, and producers with a high amount of power in Hollywood could watch this film and take note of that, maybe you should consider casting Jason Momoa in your next comedy. I don't see Slumberland as the type of story that lends itself to sequels or a franchise, and you know what? That's perfectly fine with me. It's an excellent self-contained story, and not everything needs to be milked to death by expanding and stretching it out into a franchise. Let this simply be what it is, and come up with other ideas. I know there are plenty of creative people out there hungry to put their different ideas out into the world that can offer the same feelings of fun and wonder and emotional healing the same way that this story did. Thank you for watching my review. Don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe, because I still have 2 more Netflix screeners currently sitting in my preview tab that I have to watch and create reviews for. One is The Wonder, which is a Florence Pugh film, and the other is Christmas With You, which is a new holiday rom-com starring the 90s icon himself, Freddie Prinze Jr. Millennials and rom-com fans are truly being fed this holiday season, and that is fantastic. I'm also going to be sending more emails for more screeners, so who knows what other reviews you might see popping up on my channel of other upcoming Netflix releases. They've got a lot of things coming out in the next month or so that I know that I want to watch, so you'll just have to stay tuned to see what it is that I talk about here on my channel. See you in the next one. Bye!